Good morning and welcome once more to the Scottish Parliament. I hope you had a wonderful evening at the festival. With literally thousands of performances every day, there really is nowhere like Edinburgh in August. This morning we continue with culture and sustainability, and we'll hear a series of presentations before moving to the committee rooms of the Parliament to continue deliberations in greater detail. The opportunity for ministers and heads of delegations to speak in this session was extremely popular, and I'd be very grateful, as has been the case, if reflections and responses are brief and pertinent. And I'd like to invite our first keynote speaker, Stephen Feld, to address the summit. Stephen has been working in the highlands of Papua New Guinea for almost 50 years. With the support of Grateful Dead percussionist Mickey Hart, Stephen produced the acclaimed recording Voices of the Rainforest, which has brought the culture of the Basavi people of New Guinea to international attention. Unfortunately, at the last minute, he wasn't able to be with us in person, so he recorded his presentation, complete with an audiovisual excursion to the lush rainforests near Mount Basavi.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for your generous introduction. My name is Stephen Feld. I'm speaking to you from Santa Fe, New Mexico, on the unceded territory of the Tewa people, to whom I offer my respects. I'm going to speak today about my work that began in 1975 as a young student going to Papua New Guinea and participating at the moment of independence in the government's program to develop the cultural sector. At the time of Papua New Guinea's independence, there was a call for people who would work in the areas of art, music, photography, film, to teach at the National Arts School, to work with the newly founded Institute of Papua New Guinea Studies and the National Museum. It was widely understood that a new nation would face enormous economic, political, and social challenges, and that these would dominate the entire spectrum of the public discourse. But at the same time, it was understood that culture was a domain of pride and resilience, and that Papua New Guineans were proud of their heritage. They were proud of their artistic heritage in particular, and that this should not only be documented, but promoted as part of the activities of the new nation. In addition to my work in Port Moresby, the national capital, I was sent out to a remote region in Papua New Guinea, the Southern Highlands, and particularly the Bosavi area. This is an area that had only been contacted in the 1950s and where there was little known except from documents by explorers and patrol officers. When I went to Bosavi, I realized right away that it was going to take me a year to learn the language well, and I settled into the rainforest environment with a local community of Kaluli people in a longhouse in a traditional village where I stayed for 2 years. And during that time, I became a student. I became an apprentice, and I learned as much as I could about the production of poetry, songs, ceremonies, and expressive culture. I had no idea that I would have to study things that were very remote to my training and understanding. I didn't know anything about birds. My music conservatory training did not teach me to listen to bird calls. I had to listen to a new music conservatory, the Conservatory of the Rainforest, where I learned every bird call, and I learned how those calls are integrated into the songs and poetry of Bosavi people. Over the years, in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, I recorded about 1,000 songs. And in those 1,000 songs, there are more than 7,000 terms for sound, light, vision, in other words, all the conditions of the weather, all the trees of the rainforest, all of the birds, all of the features of the flora and fauna of the rainforest were indicated in this poetic. One of the most important things that I came to understand by working in Bosavi with local people is that the forest is not just an extraneous world of birds and trees and insects. The forest is a spirit world, a world of ancestors. And those sounds and those sights speak to Bosabi people on an everyday basis. And this relationship with the forest turns out to be the root of the poetics of these songs. The songs not only sing about places, but they sing about relationships. Relationships gone, relationships present, relationships future. And that is expressed through singing with, singing to, and singing about the water, the birds, the land. This poetry had a profound emotional component. These songs had the capacity to move people to tears. Why? Because the songs were memory maps. It was not just a nostalgia for ancestors. It was a sense that people remain connected, remain in relation with ancestors and with others through the world of these sounds. And so the acute listening to the sounds and the reproduction of them in the songs, indeed the desire to sing with and ask me to record people singing with waterfalls or insects or birds, became a central part of the work we did together. As my relationship with Bosabi people deepened, I was called upon to be a resource, not just a researcher. To be a resource meant that I had to help people in their issues with education, with medical, with legal, and other forms of concern. Why? Because in the 1990s, the world changed tremendously with impacts on rainforests and the understanding that the rainforests are the lungs of the planet and that it was important not only to understand the history of indigenous life and the biological and ecological significance of rainforests, but the way this was a part of the history of human culture. So the important thing for me was to figure out a way that I could help be a resource. And the way I did that was to work with Bosabi people to make recordings, to make books, to make films, which projected to the outside world the significance of this poetry and this relationship to the forest that was at the heart of their artistic and cultural system. This became even more pointed in the last 20 years because of the way the global impact of climate change has begun to alter the face of all places and the lives of all people. Bosabi people have had to adapt to extraordinary changes, not just earthquakes and occasional impacts like that, but also to the sense that they were more and more remote from the nation because they were far away from the national centers. And they felt that the only way to make an impact in the world, to tell their story, was through media. This turned out to have a historic effect. In 1991, we published a CD, Voices of the Rainforest, with the help of Grateful Dead drummer Mickey Hart, and that sold 25,000 copies within a few weeks. It went on to become probably the best-selling recording of indigenous music anywhere in the world. But it was not just a CD of indigenous music. It was a CD that told the story, that portrayed the story of the way Bosabi people sing with and to and about the world that they live in, the way they map that world with their voices and with their poetry. The significance of an event like this was largely something unprecedented. I had to figure out a way that all of the royalties and resources from this recording could benefit Bosabi people. I'm not a lawyer, but with the resources from the royalties of these recordings, we've been able to hire a lawyer. So Bosabi people have had legal representation for 30 years. This is extraordinary in Papua New Guinea and extraordinary for a very small group, 2,000 people, a small group of indigenous people in a faraway place. I'm not a doctor, but the recording yielded the kinds of resources that made it possible for us to upgrade the medical system in the Bosavi area and provide resources. The recordings made their way into political offices and into the world of diplomats, and this became a considerable part of how the government understood outside researchers could collaborate with local people to help promote, through culture, the importance of the environment and the importance of poetic heritage. Scientists, sociologists, anthropologists have argued that the senses in the modern world have been effaced by various technologies and particularly by forms of noise which drown out the sounds of diversity, the sounds of the environment. There is more and more attention in ecological and environmental education to restoring habitats and particularly restoring the acoustic ecology of those habitats. The environmental movement and the study of ecology has largely focused on area and species, and the importance of species diversity and the importance of maintaining species diversity. But at this moment, in the last 25 years, we've added another important dimension to the study of ecology, and that's acoustic ecology. That is all of the sound niches, why it is that the sound environment is extraordinary for understanding the larger physical environment. A simple example, Bosavi people understand and recognize and name and sing with four different varieties of cicada. That became a very important part of a biological plan in the southern highlands to make sure that species diversity was maintained. So it may seem esoteric that people sing with and to and about cicadas, but that's a way that traditional knowledge, song forms, poetics, and acoustic ecology were combined. And because cicadas are thermometric, because they make their sounds when the temperatures rise, they have been an important part of the way scientists have been able to track climate change in places like Bosavi. So something that in 1975 might have seemed as simple as someone singing a song about a cicada turns out to be something that can be quite important to the science of climatic change and the science of environmentalism. This is the power of acoustic ecology. Whatever we think about the kind of loss that we might experience in the modern world, something is there for certain. There is a very deep historical, evolutionary, cultural, and local story about the relationship between listening and knowing, between sound as a way of knowing and the ecology and the environment and the history of poetics in a place like Bosavi. I'm honored today to be speaking to diplomats, ambassadors, and high-ranking people in the world of culture and environment. And the message that I have, the hope that I have, is that in this current moment, this current very challenging moment where we are facing tremendous amounts of environmental destruction, facing tremendous economic problems, facing tremendous social problems in many countries, I think it's important not to leave culture to the side. It's important to think about the ways in which culture is always part of these understandings. It might be part of the solutions to certain kinds of problems, even if it's not a solution to all that many. But heritage and poetry and culture have, in many places around the world, had a deep, deep relationship to understanding the environment. And if we're going to understand environmental change, we have to understand not only environments, but the indigenous knowledge of them, the traditional ecological knowledge. which includes the acoustic ecology. And I would hope that in a moment where there is so much work, so many people devoting tremendous efforts on the political and economic front to dealing with the environmental crisis, that people will also be creative and think about the resilience and the importance of culture to the work of preserving and sustaining environments. More than my words, more than my writings, the sound recordings that I've made speak most loudly about all the topics that I've addressed. And I'm honored to have the opportunity now for you to hear some of those recordings. And when you listen, just think about this, which is exactly what I thought about as a 25-year-old going to a very, very distant place for the first time. What am I hearing, and why is it important? And I asked myself that question over and over again, and it was children in Bosavi who gave me the answer. Every afternoon and every early dawn, they traveled with me as I walked into the rainforest with my microphones to try and record this world, to try and understand it. I would have a parabolic microphone and my ears enclosed in headphones, and I would put my hand up as if I knew where a bird was or if I knew where a sound was. The children all started laughing immediately. One of them, I'm talking about 10, 11, 12-year-old children, one of them would jump up and take my arm and hold it in the direction of the sound. Immediately, the bird would come into my ears. How is this possible? What kind of knowledge is this that a 10 or 11 or 12-year-old will know everything about the 19 species of birds that you're going to hear in a recording of just a few moments? What is it about the height and the depth of the world? What is it about the sensuous understanding of the world that is absorbed by young people, that's transmitted by their parents and grandparents, that's a deep part of this understanding of the world and what we can gain from recognizing the importance of recording in these environments with the help of local people?
Thank you very much, Stephen Feld. We move on to our next item, and we're going to meet Gridiron, who are an Edinburgh theatre company dedicated to presenting new work and writing from Gridiron's current Edinburgh Festival Commission, Muster Station Leith. Please welcome Olivia Sikora to the lectern. Olivia.
My name is Lena. Welcome. Firstly, I'm sorry for keeping you waiting, but as you already be aware, our systems are under quite a lot of stress. Normally, you'd need to make your first claim within the legal boundaries of Finnish territory. However, given that the UK is a historic friend of our country and the urgency of your situation, Migris has sent us here to speed up the process. We hope. Excuse me, it has been a very long day so far without the breaks, given the urgency for you and our desire to help you. As you also be aware, this will be the very last day you can apply. Is that all clear? Good. Oh, I do love your Scottish scones. The ones from the staff canteen here are especially good. Now, the questionnaire you see before you is brief. Write your name clearly on the form in front of you using the pen provided, please. The first few questions, as you can see, are very straightforward. However, let me refer you to two specific points. First point, on a personal income and or wealth. As you'll be aware, given the recent pressure on the Finnish immigration system from British asylum claimants, and issues around British people's assimilation into Finnish society, which are numerous, our government has imposed a limit on the amount of personal capital and or income an individual can personally own when applying for asylum. Finland will only extend welcome to those who genuinely cannot help themselves. Secondly, in submitting the application, you are also legally agreeing to undertake certain responsibilities if we grant you refugee status. One of these is learning to speak Finnish, which many British people have struggled with. I think this must result from your state's decision many years ago to cut modern languages from the school's curriculum, yes? Ah, well, maybe you don't have the aptitude for it. Well, alas, you must learn our language, and good luck, because it is one of the most difficult. Did you know we have one of the longest palindromes in all human language? Yes. Sai puaki vikopias, 19 letters. It means a dealer in caustic soda. You'll hardly need to know this word ever in your life, but there you go. Your Finnish lessons have started. You're welcome. So now that you have completed the basic questions, look at the question, explain your reasons for seeking asylum in Finland. Go ahead now, answer this question. Some of you are hesitating. And some of you seem to have written very little. Okay, I am here to help you. Within the rules, of course. What you say now is very important. Maybe it will decide whether you keep your life or lose it. And this is pressure, I know. But you must learn to deal with that pressure. You have to be a first-class teller of your own story. Remember, in this process, your story is your evidence, the proof of your worthiness of our help. Understand? So focus. Some of you are still struggling. Maybe you aren't used to asking for help, huh? Or your Britannia rules the waves, pride is getting in the way. As you now understand, no one rules the waves anymore. And pride is not a useful characteristic for anyone in your position. Remember, we immigration officials have heard it all before. We have a whole library of pain in our heads. Nothing you tell us can shock us. Look, let me help you. Just for a few seconds, try to remember your grandmother's face. Picture it. My grandmother didn't use a net for her face when she approached the hive. Her face was strangely without wrinkles. Although there must have been some, because my father was the youngest of 5 children, and I was the youngest of 16 grandchildren, and she was already very old, but still, no wrinkles. Her hair was absolutely silver, not gray or white, and whipped up into a big ice cream cone by its thickness and curls under her headscarf. Her eyebrows were still red. One pointed up in an everlasting question, whilst the other one tumbled down into disappointment. Her eyes were oval and a Prussian blue. I learned the name of this color later. And reflected the sunshine like 1,000 shattered pieces of a glass jug on a stone floor, flashing rage and pride and unspoken love all the time. She described her own jawline as sharp. Her teeth were gappy, but the 7 teeth she had left, 4 on the top and 3 below, were chalk white. She only smiled at children because she knew that the sophisticated adults like my parents were disgusted by it. Her lips were thin and disappeared entirely as the bee smoke made her choke and cough. I see her waving the smoke around the hive, nestled inside the trunk of a tree. These are wild bees, and their homes are wild. This is the best way to make honey, says grandmother. The bees are healthier this way. And wait until you taste it. Oh, it's nothing like the honey you buy in shops, which is made by those prisoner bees in those stupid white box things. But why do you smoke, I ask? Bees understand the world, and they talk to each other through smell, she replies. When a bee becomes alarmed, it emits a smell which tells all the other bees to be alarmed too. This smoke stops them from smelling each other's fear, and the fear spreading. But don't worry, their sense of smell comes back when I take the smoke away. Honey is a wonder drug my grandmother swears by. If you have a cold or a fever, honey, a bruise or a burn, honey, I feel like my whole life is coated in it, the way it's coated in my grandmother. My parents are academics, scientists. They believe in facts, in measurements, not dreams and folk tales. They work all the time, writing papers, giving lectures, and they do other work at nights, stirring up the devils, my grandmother calls it. But my father says they're just stirring up hope. He says our government is illegitimate, cruel, and corrupt. He says it tortures and it kills people and sometimes makes them disappear. My parents are always angry, and they're always scared. Often they go into hiding, and so most of the time we stay at grandmother's house. On that day when everything changed, I was almost 13 years old. My father had gone into hiding again a week ago, and despite my mother having been arrested and interrogated for 3 days, all was quiet. Too quiet, mother said. Pack your bags, only bring essentials. And when we got to grandmother's house, the first thing we noticed was that the front door was shut. Weird. And the barn door was open, which my grandmother considers a crime. My mother stops the car, but doesn't get out. I run into the house. My grandmother lies on the floor. Her ice cream hair has melted all over the floor into blood, and her headscarf is torn away. She's breathing. My mother is calling someone on the phone, and she's weeping. They came for an old woman. Can you believe it, the bastards? My grandmother lifts her head to look at me. She sees my trembling lip and she smiles. She now only has 5 teeth, 2 at the top and 3 below. I'm fine. Just bring me some honey to put on my wounds, she said. This all happened on the 7th of July.
Now, this is the type of account we want, huh? Rich in detail. But what is wrong with this account? Your question is, explain why you're seeking asylum in my country. Your story is your evidence, yes, but we are not actually interested in your actual life story, just the facts which answer the question we're asking you. You might, like this child, think certain things are important, but they are not to us, so pick the relevant facts. This girl was 12 years old on this fateful day. Her parents were the opposition party members in her country. She does not say which party. She does not give their names. This is bad. She gives us a date. 7 July. Good, but no year. Bad. She does not give the grandmother's name nor the location of her house. Bad. She gives us some very detailed physical descriptions of the injuries her grandma sustained. Good, but not who inflicted them. Bad. But she is thinking of her senses all the time. What she tastes, sees, hears, smells, touches. This is good, very important, because the sensory information gives credibility to her story. See? We need it to be detailed, but concise, accurate, and specific with dates, locations, times of events. Be chronological, be vivid, but be relevant. Understand? Remember, you are the expert of your own story. Feel power, relax, and try again. Explain your reasons for seeking asylum in Finland. What made you pack your bag so quickly? Start there. Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. Thank you, Gridiron. I would like to now invite the Executive Director of the Art and Culture Development Foundation, which operates under the authority of the Cabinet of Ministers of the Republic of Uzbekistan, Gayana Umarova, to address us.
Good morning, dear excellencies and distinguished colleagues. I'm honored to be part of this important summit. Thank you, the Scottish Parliament, for hosting, and thank you all for joining. I'm doubtless that we will have a prominent discussion and the outcomes related to the topic today of plenary session. The foundation has been established in 2017 to support the President of the Republic of Uzbekistan initiative to develop a broaden all the aspects of art, culture, architecture and education in the country, and to set up a vision for world culture cooperation. Our values are coherent with the needs and current time, and we see our objectives and the worldwide exchange of knowledge. The topic of sustainability is becoming more and more crucial throughout the world, and for sure we see it as our main commitment to developing all the possible solutions in resolving the issues of this area. Today we've heard, and we will be hearing even more about the notion of sustainability from our colleagues, and from all over the world, and we can clearly see that we speak of sustainability. It relates to all aspects of our daily routine and to all aspects of our existence. We can relate it to the architecture, education, art, ecology, sociology, inclusivity, and many others. I have to outline that the foundation engages actively in all the status spheres, and we seek for solution on all the possible grounds. As the Secretary General for the National Commission of the Republic of Uzbekistan for UNESCO, I would like to draw your attention to the matter of rapid urbanization in the cities and also to the rural areas of our countries. We have been facing this problem in the large cities of Uzbekistan. On one hand, we understand that it's difficult to prevent it as the population is growing, as well as the economy emerges, and we need to find ways to smoothen the process for the environment. On the other hand, we have to reduce the pressure on the old part of the cities. Several years ago, we had quite an urgent matter related to the saving all neighborhoods, mahallas, in the capital of Uzbekistan, Tashkent. Most parts of mahallas were heavily demolished by the owners of the houses and property developers. However, considering these old structures as a bright example of sustainable architecture that combines itself traditional and proper building houses of decorating, as well as it carries a long history of cultural traditions, we believe that it's of very high value to the country's development of all grounds. Therefore, we assume that the best solution would be to draw attention of the international audience to the local government to this problem throughout the prism of artistic approach. We took the opportunity to discuss vernacular architecture in the notion of phenomena that can give us so much to contemporary architecture and social development. In this sense, it's worth mentioning that it was the first time of our country succeeded launching its national pavilion at the 17th International Architecture Exhibition, La Biennale di Venezia, in 2021. The Mahalla Urban-Rural Living Exhibition highlighted the multi-faced nature of Mahalla, its complex structure, and its role of a culture of Uzbekistan within contemporary and from historical perspective. I'm honored to say that the foundation has been appointed as a commissioner of this pavilion. It was the first attempt to examine the notion of Mahallas together with our wonderful curators, Emmanuel Christ and Christoph Gantenbein, professors of one of the top universities of the world, ETH Zurich. Within this period of 3 years, and with a team of curators, architectural and local experts, we examined Mahallas as an institution of the social architectural phenomenon that combines itself a unique tradition of Islamic way of living together with a sustainable traditional architecture. The main idea behind our investigation was to find the answers to such questions, such as Mahalla have been transforming throughout the decades, where it has its roots, what's the contemporary way of Mahalla living, and how it can sustain. Our broad research gave us the opportunity to find the answers to many addressed questions and even more. In 3 years' time, we have come up with several projects in this field of the refurbishment of the old mahallas of Tashkent. As a result of this presentation of our research and investigation, we launched a project that preserves the 14 historical mahalas in Tashkent in partnership with UNESCO and other stakeholders. This is a pilot project that might later be extended to the other historical sites in Uzbekistan. As a result, 14 mahalas in Tashkent have been included in the World Heritage Tentative List of UNESCO. In partnership with the University of ATH, we are creating a design code for one of the oldest mahalas in the city, and it will serve as a benchmark and for careful consideration and preservation for other parts of the Tashkent in future. We believe that this case study of the mahalla in existing importance in the context of emerging cities throughout the world and can also become a benchmark not only for Central Asia but for the other parts of the planet, where the urban structures and contemporary way of living are replacing the traditional architecture and customs we are so much used to. In this sense, of course, Uzbekistan and many other of its cities are also facing the reality, can serve as an important precedent of such experience. Last but not least, for those who you might know, the Aral Sea, located in the Qoraqalpakistan autonomous parts of Uzbekistan, which used to be the world's fourth largest lake back in 1960s, has shrunk to its half of its former size, and it's a really ecological catastrophe for the region. In order to see the impact of this situation on the area, the Uzbek government have been launching a series of scientific expeditions throughout the years and commissioned vast number of projects on improvement of this situation. As a cultural institution, we see our mission to support these initiatives. Therefore, in autumn 2023, the foundation will be inaugurating the Biennial of Sustainability, which will focus on sustainable architecture, new materials, energy, earth, and soil. The centerpiece of this project is a specially commissioned organic farm that combines contemporary technologies and practices with a traditional way of planting. The farm will become a place of exchange, creating an embracing dialogue between different scholars, artists, architects, and many others, and will operate throughout the year. It is designed as a multidisciplinary platform where any research can find its interest and tools for new discovery. I believe these activities will help us to draw even more attention to the problem of sustainability in urban and rural areas of the country and to remain steadfast forward positive change in culture and environment. Once again, I'm very delighted to be here. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Umarova. I would now like to invite Stephen Stenning, former Director of Arts Middle East North Africa, based in Cairo, for the British Council to the lectern. Stephen will be joined by Mina Girgis on a video link from the United States this morning. And Stephen and Mina will be discussing the incredible musical collaboration that is the Nile Project. Mina is the founder of the unique musical and environmental celebration of a great river and the role it plays in the daily lives of the hundreds of millions of people who live along its banks as it flows through 11 countries from Egypt to South Sudan. But before they address the summit, we will be able to enjoy a short video about this amazing project.
I'm going to send you the song, maybe you can just listen, because no, it's not going to be time.
And,
one, two, three.
One, two, three, and four.
The time with you are
here,
and
you have to
go.
One, two, three, four. Hey, one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four.
I think problem is pronunciation,
yes,
yeah?
Yeah.
But you have to write and then you will read at night, yeah? But that's the rhythm.
So one way could be boo-doom, boo-doom, doom-doom, doom-doom, right? Which is what the original was. He could also boo-doom, 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 doom-doom, just for variation.
Katoya ote no mangima, kato winzo ling tigiluro.
Imaya roka, eka winzo nyeroni, katoya ote no mangima, kati winzo ling tigiluro.
Heo dumbe kendo, kendo tula nyongoro betmos, duk bende no dagi modo, kata guok no dagi duogo.
Hey, dumbe kendo, kita tula nyangoro bitmos, no dagi dogo, kata guok no dagi dogo.
Kendo anago negi
sigala gala.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as you may be able to tell by the sense of panic on my face, this relied on not just that video, but a live link to the west coast of America. Mina, can you hear me and we can see you? And hopefully you can get an impression of the Parliament as well. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you, Stephen. Can you hear me okay?
That's brilliant. Great. Neither of us is on mute, so that's a really good start. So thank you for joining us, because I'm aware that it is It is nearly 3 o'clock in the morning in San Francisco where you are, so this is a feat as far as you're concerned of sustainability in itself. So what I'm going to look to do is just have, we've seen the video and the amazing musical energy that came from it. I just want to, through a bit of a discussion, highlight how it came about, but also how it related to a massive developmental ambition, no less than a multinational sharing of the waters of the Nile. So, welcome to this cultural summit and this conversation on culture and sustainability. Important debate in this Scottish Parliament, surrounded and in the context of the Edinburgh Festival's great performances. Additionally, this year, also some very artistic arrangements of rubbish. First question. I came across the Nile Project through the wonderful musician, Egyptian musician Fatih Salema, and in one backstreet smoky bar, him getting really excited about the musicians he was going to connect with in a residency. So perhaps you could just give us a sense of where the project came from, and how you would describe it as both a musical and a sustainability challenge.
It's a pleasure to be with you today, and I wish I could be there in person, but I think the connection is good enough, so we'll keep it here. The Nile Project started in 2011. I am an ethnomusicologist by background, and I was in Cairo during the Arab Spring, and at that time I heard about Ethiopia's plan to build the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. At that point, most Egyptians were distracted by Mubarak and the Muslim Brotherhood and the military. There was a lot of political uncertainty in the air, but I was more worried about the hydropolitical storm that would be coming our way with Ethiopia's plan to construct the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, and the fact that Egyptians are not really in any way aware of the history of the Nile water conflict and where it would be going. At that point, I didn't know much myself, but I could see that citizen diplomacy platform that would allow citizens from the different Nile countries to have a conversation about their history, their shared environmental resources, and the future of their environmental sustainability around the river that means so much to all of them, was missing and was really important. Now, I happen to be an ethnomusicologist who specializes in stories that span multiple geographies. I worked with Yo-Yo Ma on the Silk Road Project, and I worked on the music of the Roma or the Gypsies and their migration from India into the Middle East and Europe. So I could see that there was a need for a conversation. And I, based on my background, I thought music could really play a role in creating a space for curiosity, creating space for both the environmental as well as the cross-cultural curiosity that we need for these dialogues to take place and education to follow. So the Nile Project started with our first residency in Aswan, Egypt in 2013. It was an experiment. We brought together 18 musicians from the 11 Nile countries. And over 2 weeks, we had a music school where we had master classes and followed by a creative process to allow everyone to collaborate. We created 5 hours worth of music that we ended up performing in our world premiere in Aswan. And the impact was so profound. We saw people in Aswan just completely affected by the experience that we decided we're going to continue. So we kept growing over the year and touring after that.
Thank you very much, Mina. And I remember really well from seeing a performance in Al-Azhar Park, the amazing combination of musicians and the result of that combination of musicians. Hearing from you about that sort of perceiving the need to start a conversation that wasn't going on, and that conversation needing to span a number of nations, I can see how the thought that particularly musicians, a band of well-known musicians and might work engaging young people. I think it's a really interesting thought. How did you... You also got money, I think, from the Swiss Development Agency. You got support from a range of people. How did you go about persuading people that the best way of dealing with this issue that is pertinent to so many countries, I think it was 9, 11, 13 countries down the Nile, was best dealt with through creating a band? How did you stage that conversation?
I'll have to say it wasn't always an easy conversation. I was met with a lot of skepticism from those who are more on the environmental side of things. This said, water people, especially people who had been working on the water conflict, got it right away. As soon as I would speak about the project to someone who's been working on the Nile water conflict, they'd be like, yeah, that's it. That's exactly what we need right now. What we don't have is projects that build trust. And the reason why the 11 countries of the Nile have not signed the Nile Cooperative Framework Agreement, which they have been negotiating for the last 23 years, is because of that lack of trust. So we needed to engage a citizen diplomacy for people to start having this conversation. But it wasn't just about music. It was the Nile Project was a musical project, and it's well known as a musical project. But we had a dialogue program. We had an education program for university students. We had a research program for faculty members from different universities in the Nile Basin. So we were really trying to use the music to engage people, to get people's attention, and to show them what's possible when citizens from these countries get together to come up with something creative. What are the possibilities of doing something when you're not a diplomat or a hydrologist? Because it takes a little bit of time for people to see how they fit in as a teacher, as a journalist, as a scientist, when they're not working directly on water issues. I think that's what sold it to the development agency.
Thanks. And there was a really good sense there as well of the not just the scope and scale of the project, but the sort of interdisciplinary nature as well. Last question. I think there's a lot there for us to explore about the connection art and big challenges, the role of art, music as well. How would you sum up the impact of the Nile Project, Mina?
That's a big question, Stephen, and it's a question that we actually spent a lot of energy trying to measure the impact of this music on cross-cultural empathy, on environmental empathy. But one thing I would say that was very clear was the paradigm shift that we saw in our audiences wherever we went, going from only knowing their immediate neighbors, their immediate land neighbors. Egyptians know their Sudanese neighbors. They don't know much beyond Egypt, Ethiopia, or maybe South Sudan. So getting a sense of the Nile as a region and as a community, seeing that on stage, it's a nonverbal message. I mean, most of our concerts had like more than 10 languages, so no one really understood what we were singing about. But it triggered curiosity. And I think the main message was everyone thinking, what is my Nile project? What am I going to do about this with whatever I happen to have in my hands? So that was the impact. We did a lot of education programs, and I'm happy to speak to you in more detail about them as well.
Thank you very much, Mina. Thank you. Thank you for being so lucid at 3 o'clock in the morning, and we will let you get back to bed. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a great summit.
Thank you very much, Stephen and Mina, and yes, absolutely. Thank you for staying awake to be with us. I think we've all enjoyed that discussion. We will now hear further ministerial and heads of delegations' reflections and responses, and I call on the Minister of Culture, Youth and Sport from the Republic of Kosovo, Hajrullah Çeço, to speak to us. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Dear ladies and gentlemen, this has been a truly rewarding experience. I would like to thank the organizers for their invitation and for putting together a wonderful program for the Culture Summit. I am particularly delighted to be in Edinburgh in the 75th anniversary of the Fringe Festival. We have witnessed wonderful presentations from culture policymakers and practitioners from around the world. Thought-provoking, enlightening, highly informative, courageous, and visionary presentations. A lot of new ideas and perspectives on cultural policy and the ways art impacts our societies, economies, education systems, environments, our lives. A lot of new dilemmas as well. That constant struggle of decision makers, the never-ending pursuit of finding the right programs and the right tools, drafting the relevant policy documents, always trying to make sure that the potential of arts and culture is best utilized for the benefit of the people. Grateful to all of you for sharing your experiences and your views during summit sessions, and also to the ministers and officials of the United Kingdom, Qatar, Latvia, Ukraine, Wales, and the US Arts Endowment, with whom we had bilateral meetings and exchanges during these days. We are returning home better equipped and informed, more confident, and with a wider network of friends. Some challenging times await us in the coming months in the Republic of Kosovo. Earlier this week, our government adopted the concept document on arts and culture, a thorough analysis of the current state of affairs in the culture sector in our country. A document that sets a new vision for cultural development in Kosovo, designed through a participatory process and providing a wide and deep sectoral diagnosis. The cure we ought to find is centered around one word, sustainability. Our country is going through total legal and institutional reform process in culture, aiming to reduce the bureaucratic burden to arts institutions and artists, to design effective granting schemes, to build audiences, increase our international presence through arts. In addition to sectoral interventions, our government is committed to integrate culture into other policy areas. Although it was widely covered yesterday, we consider arts education a central feature of sustainable communities. A new arts education program that has been recently designed will significantly increase the participation of school children in artistic life. We believe that reduced legal and administrative bureaucracy means more effective structures to run cultural programs and institutions in our country. Better programming and channeling of funds would mean an even stronger independent culture sector. And above all, integrating arts and culture into education, healthcare, spatial planning, economic growth would directly contribute to sustainable outcomes that can be measured by quality of life indicators. We pay special attention to integrating cultural heritage into planning and environmental protection and management, ensuring the landscape approach prevails over the conventional understanding of heritage preservation. The vision of our new cultural policy and cultural development strategy is sustainable communities. Our nation is resilient. We experienced oppression, apartheid, war, and genocide during the 1990s. We carried on. In 2008, declared our independence. This year, our capital city, Pristina, is hosting the nomadic biennial manifesta. Next year, we will establish our Museum of Modern Art. Our talented filmmakers and musicians are awarded in the prestigious international arts events. Our new cultural policy, therefore, should further unleash the creativity potential of Kosovar youth. That is why we are kindly asking for your help, guidance, and cooperation to design a sustainable cultural governance system. And one more kind request to our European friends, please do lift the absurd visa regime and let us travel freely. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. May I now ask K.M. Khalid, the Honourable State Minister of Cultural Affairs of the People's Republic of Bangladesh, to share his perspectives with us. Minister
Thank Khalid. You very much. Honourable Presiding Officer, Honourable Ministers, respected officials, cultural professionals and your delegates, ladies and gentlemen, Shubho Shokal. Good morning. Good morning to you all. First of all, I would like to thank the UK and Scottish Government for inviting me at Edinburgh International Cultural Summit 2022 and giving me this opportunity to reflect the keynote address of this culture and sustainability plenary session. Before going to my speech, I would like to pay my deepest respect to the greatest Bengali ever, the father of the Bengali nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, and to his family members. Freedom fighters of 1971 who laid down their lives for the independence of Bangladesh. I would also like to thank all keynote speakers for presenting their keynotes on culture and sustainability. Bangladesh is a South Asian country with strong cultural diversity. It has 165 million people, of that 1.6 million come from 50 small ethnic groups with different cultural heritage. The constitution of our country also recognizes the right of those ethnic groups too. Dear chairpersons, ensuring cultural sustainability in Bangladesh, we have a cultural policy. The Ministry of Cultural Affairs provides the legal framework, sets the objectives, financial arrangements, and the organizational structures that forms the basis of the cultural policy in Bangladesh. In line with the state policy, Bangladesh already ratified several international conventions, protocols, charters, and guidelines of UNESCO. Bangladesh has also cultural exchange agreement and the memorandum of understanding with as many as 44 countries in the world right at the moment. Dear participants, culture is a driver for sustainable development. We Bangladesh government are committed to strengthen our cultural aspects to accomplish Agenda 2030 of UNO. The climate vulnerable countries like Bangladesh are adversely affected by the COVID-19 pandemic as well as natural disaster in the past couple of years. Our SDGs progresses were badly hit. However, we have been able to show strong resilience to tackle the impact of this crisis under the prudent guidance and dynamic leadership of Honorable Prime Minister of Bangladesh, Her Excellency Sheikh Hasina. Bangladesh government has continued to support different cultural festivals and activities throughout these difficult times. During pandemic and post-pandemic, Bangladesh government financially support vulnerable artists and cultural organizations throughout the country. Distinguished persons, we strongly believe that by working towards achieving SDGs, we can achieve our dream of building an ideal nation and an ideal world. Through our ministry, we strongly focus on the SDGs such as gender equality, reduced inequalities, decent work and economic growth, climate actions and peace, justice and strong institutions. To build an inclusive society, we are prioritizing our work in the disability sector culturally. We have been closely involved in the development and mainstreaming disability arts in Bangladesh in partnership with the British Council since 2013. Our agenda is to change the perception of the society through the medium of arts. The nationwide project Disability Arts Redefining Empowerment has been the major initiative by the British Council since 2019 to bridge the gaps between the person with disabilities and wider society. Dear Speaker and audience, we are prioritizing to preserve and protect our cultural heritage and showcase this to the world. We are protecting the heritage sites of Bangladesh and taking steps to preserve the rich history connected to these places. As of today, we have 4 ICHS, 2 TCHS listed in the UNESCO's representative list. The historical speech of the 7th March of Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, father of the Bengali nation, registers as documentary heritage of UNESCO. The Sundarban of Bangladesh, which is the largest mangrove forest of the world, popularly known as House of the Royal Bengal Tiger, listed as natural heritage of UNESCO. We encourage people to visit us, see the beautiful things and places that we have, and join us in the celebration of life. Finally, I would like to say we have been working towards achieving a culturally sustainable Bangladesh and have been working with different development partners like the British Council, UNESCO, etc. We truly believe that these international collaborations are the heart of our work for a culturally balanced, sustainable Bangladesh. I thank you once again for having me today at this inspiring program and for this opportunity to represent Bangladesh here. I wish this summit a great success. Thank you all. Joy Bangla, Joy Bangabandhu, Bangladesh, long live.
Thank you, Minister. I now welcome the Vice Minister of Culture and Tourism from the People's Republic of China, Mr. Rio Kwan, who joins us via video link from Beijing. Vice Minister.
尊敬的各位嘉宾,
distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to join you at the 6th Edinburgh International Culture Summit and have this opportunity to share. Development is mankind's eternal pursuit. It is a universal recognition that sustainable development is important. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development at the UN General Assembly in September 2015 provides a shared blueprint for all countries to pursue sustainable development in a global partnership. Within the framework of the Sustainable Development Goals, the International Development Agenda refers to culture, making global recognition of culture's crucial role in the SDGs. Many countries, including China, have placed culture at the heart of their national policies as a powerful engine for sustainable development. Today, the world is beset by global changes and a pandemic, both unseen in a century. World economic recovery is facing headwinds. Development cooperation is losing steam. The implementation of the 2030 Agenda is facing unprecedented challenges. However, development remains a priority for all countries, and in such trying times, we must look out for each other and promote further dialogue, cooperation, and shared development. Last year, Chinese President Xi Jinping proposed the Global Development Initiative, GDI, at the 76th session of the United Nations General Assembly and called on the international community to accelerate the implementation of the 2030 Agenda for a more robust, greener, and more balanced global development and foster global community development with a shared future. The GDI represents China's solution to pool global resources and solve difficult issues of development across the world. As President Xi noted, Mutual respect, solidarity and harmonious coexistence are the right path for the development of human civilization. China is willing to work with the community internationally to promote equality, mutual learning, dialogue, inclusiveness among civilizations, to replace estrangement with exchange, clashes, mutual learning, superiority with coexistence, and to build a community with a shared future for mankind. In the past 2 years, in response to COVID-19, the Chinese government took a series of actions to help the cultural sector recovery, including emergency grants, loans, tax, free deduction and social insurance relief packages. At the same time, China also quickened its pace to launch a national digital culture strategy, which aims at building a comprehensive inventory of culture and heritage, making culture more accessible to all, mandating equal opportunity to contribute and benefit from cultural life, and creating an inclusive environment to support creativity inspired by heritage, music, literature, arts. And such a strategy has focused on rebuilding a dynamic cultural sector in the post-pandemic era, a sector that will be a strong driving force behind social and economic recovery and sustainable development. Dear colleagues, we are entering the third decade of the 21st century. Right now, we are facing multiple challenges and changes that are unfolding like never before. The role of culture is crucial in connecting people, achieving sustainable development goals, and building a community of shared future for mankind. The Ministry of Culture and Tourism of China looks forward to sharing vision, knowledge, and practices, and working together with our colleagues from other countries based on common goals. Hereby, I propose the following. First, we must be open and inclusive in cultural exchange. Cultural diversity is necessary for mankind. This diversity is embodied in the uniqueness and plurality of identities, of groups and societies. And if we acknowledge the value of all cultural expressions, find beauty within differences, respect and celebrate diversity, and develop empathy instead of judgment, we can keep our cultures viable and thriving, increase our mutual understanding, and pave the way for more productive international cultural cooperation based on connectivity and inclusiveness. Second, we must harness innovation to promote global development. Innovation is one primary force that drives growth. Technology in forms such as big data, cloud computing, blockchain, and AI affects every aspect of the society and economy today. It is also a crucial impact on culture. We should further embrace digital advances on the internet and smart technology, work together to build robust digital infrastructure, and leverage digital tools to drive growth process across the cultural sector for the benefit of our peoples. Third, we must work with an implementation-oriented approach and carry out more cooperation projects. People-to-people ties form a key pillar in international cooperation. While maintaining our existing dialogues and working mechanisms, we seek opportunities to build new platforms of cultural exchange and cooperation. If we can develop stronger partnerships based on effective collaboration, mutual learning and understanding, we will bring our cultural exchange to the next level, share more fruits of growth, and find better solutions to common challenges we face. I wish the 6th Edinburgh International Culture Summit a complete success. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Vice Minister. I now welcome Masa Vlarabovic, Minister of Culture and Media from Montenegro.
Thank you. Estimate colleagues, allow me to present my compliments on behalf of the Ministry of Culture and Media of Montenegro and to express gratitude for the invitation to attend this significant event. The summit provides us as an opportunity to exchange experiences about cultural policies we are implementing in our countries while aiming to integrate the best practice in our activities and projects, thus contributing to both promotion of our cultural expression and cooperation processes. This event is also traditional, targeting global issues in the field of culture together with a possible model to overcome them while opening new perspectives for institutional networking of different countries. I'm very glad we are discussing about important topics related to culture, and in this context, the relation between culture and sustainability is a great significant in contemporary world where climate change are one of the biggest challenges at global level influencing all aspects of life. As representatives of the institutions that are in the charge of culture policies in our countries, we have an obligation to incorporate activities that promote sustainable development and green policies in our strategic orientation. In addition, investments into infrastructure and fostering innovative projects that have potential for further development and self-sustainability are necessary if we want to achieve sustainable development in the field of culture. In this context, I would like to emphasize that the culture policy in Montenegro is oriented toward the creation of infrastructural conditions for development of culture, and the previous period, we aim to provide new proposals to the object of cultural heritage that were not in good condition, and to enable them to be in a function of sustainable culture. This is why today we have three functional creative hubs in Kotor, Bar and Šavnik that are at the same time spaces for the work and the residences for artists, artistic exchanges and diverse events in the field of culture and artistic creativity and cultural heritage. In addition, these spaces are aimed for development of creative industry sector as a field that has started to develop in our country in recent years. Being aware of the potential that creative industry sector has as a generator of economic benefits and self-sustainability, we will further focus our attention for development of projects from this field. Additionally, Montenegro is full member of EU most important programs for culture and innovation, Creative Europe and Horizon Europe. The membership in these programs allows our sector to use the significant funds for development of projects that foster cooperation and promotion of culture and innovation with special emphasis on European Green Deal as an initiative that refers to the reduction of negative influences of climate changes in Europe and emission of harmful gases. In addition, one of the topics of both programs is the new European Bauhaus as an initiative that reflects to development of sustainable and inclusive future and surrounding that is inspired by art and culture and harmonized with nature. In the forthcoming period, we will focus our activities on the promotion of these possibilities and wider participation of Montenegro culture, creative and research sectors in these projects. I am convinced that through culture we can raise awareness about important problems the world is facing with and to give positive examples about the mechanisms of sustainable development and green transitions. Thus, I find necessary that our country foster activities aimed for the support of arts, culture and creative sector and provide the condition for their sustainable and economical valorized work. In the times of economic, political and social crisis Europe and the whole world is currently in, we have an obligation to network and try to make culture a universal tool that creates condition for cooperation and self-sustainability. Certainly that in this context we will enhance our joint activities. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Minister. One of the most talked about new shows at the festival this year is an innovative reimagining of Rudyard Kipling's classic, The Jungle Book, and I am delighted that the creative force behind The Jungle Book Reimagined, Akram Khan, can be with us to share a personal perspective of his latest creation. Akram Khan.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you to the Scottish Parliament. I'm a bit confused because I thought perhaps we're going to have a video, right? Oh, we do. Okay. So let's start with a video before I talk. Action before words.
For those who have ears to listen, and for those who have a heart to feel.
We memorize your laws, human! Our brains are full of them!
Ladies and gentlemen, within the growing catastrophe, I believe there's an incredible opportunity, not just for the...
We want to become...
You!
How dare...
In the beginning was the jungle, but none of us know when that was. The jungle was created by Tha and the first of the elephants. Tha and the elephants created our home. When they mixed earth and water, trees and plants rose up from the ground. Nature had begun.
We looked at what's the essence of the story, but also what do we want to say about now and the world we live in now, and particularly climate change and how we are going against nature. We are trying to dominate nature in many ways. So we've taken all the favourite characters of Mowgli, Baloo, Bagheera. We've got those characters there, but they've been completely reimagined. I think one of the biggest changes that we've done is we have brought it to a city, so we're not in a jungle. And this idea of what would it be like for these animals, these outsiders, to congregate in a man-made environment.
They became extinct. But man did not stop there.
We are right here now, and we are dealing with climate change. At some point, we shifted. Our civilization shifted, and we started to feel that we control nature. We are not guests, but we are owners of nature, of Earth. The young generation are so, so engaged in reversing that thinking of being owners, but actually we are guests as much as the other species.
Individually, I feel empowered by exploring being in an animal, being something that is considered less than to wider society. I feel like this piece is pointing a big finger at human beings. I hope kids feel inspired but also learn something.
Nature fought back. Nature had begun.
How do we want our home to be left for the next generation? And that's something we wanted it for the children to see. We want them to see this show and to realize they are the gatekeepers. They are the ones who are the future of the planet. And we need to give them their voice. And that's what hopefully the show will do.
So once again, I'd like to thank the Scottish Parliament for hosting this, and thank you, Jonathan, for inviting me to talk. I have a lot to say, but I'll try and keep it short. But I have a lot to say because I've been, you know, stuck in a house with three kids who don't want to listen to me. So, but it can be looked at in another way, where my daughter, who's the eldest, who said to me as I was writing this speech, she said, make sure that you remind them that the poor three kids have been stuck in the house with a father who wants to speak. So my daughter came up with some of the titles. I think it's very important that we start embracing and listening to the young generation, and she's been a police on climate change for a while. The moment I went public around the world saying I want to make a work that is has less carbon footprints, she said, well, Dad, you need to sell your car. It's a diesel. And she's on my case every day. But in all seriousness, we wrote this together, and I found it very interesting and cathartic to work with her on this. So, in my work with the Akram Khan Company, I've so often reached back to the past for inspiration and knowledge in trying to understand how we all got here and how we relate to the world around us. I also feel a strong urge to explore themes that are occupying the minds of most of the children and parents today. But this urge is mostly because I'm a parent of three. Climate change is here. That's what my daughter wrote. And being a parent of three, I became concerned about the kind of myths that exist today and the children's stories that are being written for tomorrow. Hence, I wanted to find a way to take a known familiar story and observe it through the lens of today's children, my children, our children, who are and will become our present and future storytellers. Again, she wrote, climate change is non-fiction. So the Jungle Book adventure became a real challenge for me, the AKC team, and for all my creative collaborators, because we had to re-examine firstly our individual practices, and secondly, our shared processes. But to begin such a complex journey, we had to first integrate this truth of climate change into our thinking, into our habits, into our conversations, and then hopefully, it would feed back into the Jungle Book process, and then end up in the final creation, and so on stage, in some form or another. Again, she wrote, climate change is changing. So how do we continue to invest in creating narratives that are accessible, universal, and most importantly, necessary to tell, to absorb, to integrate into the minds and hearts of adults and the children of today? Because only when it becomes a part of our performative experience does it become a part of our culture. What I'm trying to say is that climate crisis is also a crisis of culture. She wrote, climate change is at a tipping point. Like the climate crisis, I feel as an artist, I'm now at a tipping point. However, I feel it's extremely important to clarify something. I do not look at this artistic tipping point to be necessarily negative. It's not all negative. I actually believe that this kind of change that is occurring is an essential part of an artist's journey. She wrote, climate change is both past and future. Through this new approach to storytelling, I would like to make amends of our past stories, but more importantly, I would like to give hope to the children of today, because we so need hope to drive us through this wall that has and will continue to prevent humanity from moving. And when I say moving, I mean moving forwards, but I also mean moving backwards, both happening at the same time. I know this sounds strange, but I have always believed that in movement and in sound, there are always two forces in tension with each other. You can be moving into the future as much as you can be moving into the past, both at the same time. She wrote, climate change is a duet. It's a relationship. I arrived from London yesterday, so I left London behind, and yet I moved towards Edinburgh. Both are true, and both happened and are connected. But we, the modern world, tends to give importance to one way rather than both. And so we separate our journeys, our stories, our modern histories from nature itself. It's as if nature is just a backdrop to our performance. If you examine more closely, we will find that we tend to put more emphasis on our future, which is okay, I understand this. But then by default, we seem to forget our past, as if it is irrelevant because it is gone, it is behind you, because our focus is only towards the future. And so I ask all of you to perhaps re-examine, to reconsider, to re-evaluate the possibility that maybe we should equally be looking into the future with questions as much as we should be looking into our past for answers. I want to share with you this anecdote, this story about, a friend told me, he's a director, wonderful director, and he shared it with me in the dressing room. It's about the Amazonian tribe. There's one particular tribe, and it's about an American journalist, photographer, who flew in, who dropped out of the plane, jumped out of the plane, landed in the Amazonian tribe, the forest, and he wanted to meet this tribe, a tribe that has never met a Westerner. And he was there for 2 weeks, no encounter with anyone. Eventually, obviously, he's not equipped to live there, so he became ill and was almost dying. At the point of dying, the tribe then went and saved him. He spent a few years with that tribe. The tribe didn't let him go. But after a few years, he said he could speak the language, and he said, I want to go back to America. So he went back to America. Then he came back. The moment he went to America, he said, I need to go back. But he took with him his father's watch as a gift. And he went back to the Amazonian tribe who had saved him, who had helped him, who he had learned from, who are so interconnected to the forest, to the world. And he said, he presented him this clock. And the tribe, the chief, looked at it and said, oh, it's moving in a particular direction. He said, yes. In modern thinking, in Western thinking, let's say, the future is in front of you. So you're going towards your future. And the past is behind you because it's gone. And the chief of the Amazonian tribe smiled. And he said, we look at it differently. He said, what do you mean? How else would you see time? He said, well, the way we see time is the past is in front of you because you can see everything that has happened. And the future is behind you because you cannot see what is ahead. And so it was interesting. I wanted to use that anecdote because art does that. It allows you to see things differently, perhaps reverse the way we are seeing it right now. And so it makes me wonder if we all need to go back and learn from the Amazonian tribes, not just about the concept of time, but also how to find a deep and meaningful way to bring back the connection and interdependence we had and should still have with nature. Our stories should once again hold within it our relationship to nature. What we create, when we create, how we create, should all be informed by our past equally as much as our future. Our answers are in our past, not in our future. We have to listen to our past for the mistakes we've made. And my daughter finally wrote, climate change is real. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Akram, and please do thank your daughter too. May I also thank all who've contributed to make this session on culture and sustainability so thought-provoking. We'll be moving to policy breakout sessions now. A member of the Parliament team will advise you as to where you need to be next, and I hope to see you after lunch for the Summit 22 closing plenary. Thank you.